Well, today my conversation is with author and Johns Hopkins professor, Jessica Fanzo. You ever think about where your food comes from? I mean, really comes from, the journey that it takes. Well, her new book, Can Fixing Dinner Fix the Planet, is what we're going to talk about. Thank you so much for talking with me here today.
Thanks for having me, Kim.
So you need to tell me, say it's true. Say it's true. Just by fixing dinner, we can fix the planet.
Yes. Yeah, the answer to that question is yes, we can. It's quite a bumpy road to get there, but we can do it.
And so where do we begin?
I think, you know, there's multiple places. One is to start on our plates, you know, with dinner. We can change the kind of foods we eat. We can change the way we think about food and not wasting food. We can think about where our food comes from and who we want to support, what kind of farmers we want to support. So there's lots of things we as the eaters can do to empower ourselves and how we engage with the global food system.
So but what's the wake-up call? Like, what was your wake-up call for you? Like, where you put it together, where it was chronic disease is linked to food and weakened immune systems?
Two things. The massive burden of malnutrition. So the increase in obesity, 2.1 billion people are overweight and obese. That's incredible. Yeah. And still a huge number, almost a billion people who are hungry. So that was one thing, is this hunger obesity paradox. The second was climate change. It's just barreling down on us. And our time to actually reverse it is like the sand in the hourglass, right? The days of our lives are numbered here, right? So climate change is really a scary proposition. And when I see, I'm at Johns Hopkins, and I see students and how they feel about climate change, I think that visceral feel for younger populations really calls for immediate action to do something about it.
You know, I buy a lot of stuff from the past, like vintage, you know, vintage clothing. There was a time when I bought vintage clothing, and it was weird because, like, there isn't any plus size vintage clothing, right? And so someone posted a photo on Facebook yesterday, Tom Weschler, who's a photographer, and he posted a photo of Goose Lake, which was kind of like a Woodstock here in Michigan. And someone commented on the photo. It was like just a sea of people. He goes, look, there's not one fat person. So when did processed food like start ruining us?
Yeah, the whole processed packaged food is a huge contributor to obesity and chronic disease that we see. And that diet is moving around the world. Yeah. So if you go to rural Tanzania, you know, where there's still smallholder farmers, you'll see a little kiosk with processed packaged foods like candy and chips and all of the stuff that we in the United States have been consuming for a long time. This has been going on as with industrialization of food. And these foods
When was that?
It started in the 40s and 50s. I mean, think about the TV dinners and all of those, what we thought was this wonderful technology has sort of backfired on us.
Yeah.
Because these foods are now everywhere. They're cheap. They're tasty. They're really tasty. And this is a problem, right? And they're very convenient. And that model of the American industrialized food system has sort of proliferated around the world. And we've seen obesity rise right at that time. You know, we've seen it over the decades.
So even though we're overweight, are we meeting our nutritional needs? That's the big question, right?
No one. I mean, you look at diets around the world, no one is consuming the World Health Organization's recommendation for fruits and vegetables per day, which is 400 grams per person. No one is meeting that. No one is eating enough whole grains. Nuts, legumes, beans. Most of the world's population is consuming a lot of sugar, a lot of oils, and these processed packaged foods. The healthy diet is not the dominant diet around the world. unfortunately.
And oftentimes that breeds disease, right? It's a perfect environment. You studied the stuff on a molecular level. It's like mind-boggling. It breeds weaknesses in our body, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. If you're not meeting your nutritional needs, you're not getting the essential nutrients, the vitamins and minerals into your body. And that creates a whole host of hidden problems that emerge much later in life, puts you at risk for certain diseases. And a lot of it, it's kind of the silent killers.
Yeah.
Right? It builds over time. I mean, you see the obvious sort of undernutrition situations in some places in Africa still, where it's very visceral. You see a child who's starving, or you see a child who's not growing because they are so severely undernourished. But these kind of suboptimal diets that we see in the United States, it builds over time. The risk factors are sort of these silent risk factors until, you know, you're 55 and you're wondering, why did I have a heart attack? I thought I ate healthy.
Yeah, I mean, I know you read labels, right? You read labels when you're in the grocery store. I read labels. I did a program here in Michigan called Select Michigan that basically was a program to encourage people to buy local, you know, eat local. Yeah. I did it for a full year living in Michigan. So, you know, there's some preserves that come into play there. But, you know, you have to be careful even in the grocery store. I remember shopping and seeing in a box, it said Michigan apples all at the front of the store, Michigan apples, Michigan apples. But when I picked up the apple and looked at it, it was actually a Washington apple.
Wow.
And so like you have to actually work a little bit to get all around this. You talk about eating sustainably. What does that even mean?
Yeah. Eating sustainably is really around the food choices that you make. And we can talk about that. And also I would say the other big one is wasting less food. So not throwing out so much food. Right. So on the sustainable choices, red meat, cattle are big contributors to greenhouse gas emissions, deforestation and biodiversity loss. And so moving more towards other animal source foods, like sustainably raised poultry or other seafoods, like some of the more sustainable ones are the smaller fish, like eating sardines, very popular in Italy, eating oysters, mussels, those bivalves are a sustainable option. And then eating more plant-based foods, you know, fruits and vegetables. Now, do you have to be a vegan to eat sustainably? No. But do you need to eat red meat at every meal?
Right.
No.
Right.
Maybe not.
I never felt better when I was eating more like a vegan. I really did. I think that's the way that I'm supposed to eat. I had colon cancer, you know, and my doctor said, you know, you can attribute your colon cancer, you know, pretty much to your diet. Because all I used to eat, I lost 115 pounds. Was processed food. You know, anything in a cardboard box, frozen, refrigerated, I don't know, it's easier to control what you're eating when you prepare it.
Absolutely.
And it's fast. I can do a meal in 10 minutes, you know, on a grill. Tell me about the sugar, because in your book, you have this pie chart and 3%. Right?
Yeah.
Supposed to be for sugar.
Yeah.
What is so bad about sugar? I know it's bad. My head's like a pinball machine. When I can't do it in moderation, either you do it or you don't do it.
Yeah. Sugar is one of these ingredients it's so important for food industry because it preserves food. It gives food longer shelf life. It's really important for taste. But sugar, these added sugars are detrimental to weight control, to diabetes risk, particularly for diabetes, links with cardiovascular disease. So sugar and high consumption of sugar puts us at significant risk for these chronic diseases. And so much of the foods that we buy have these hidden sugars in them. See, again, what you were saying, Kim, you really need to read the labels to see. And you'd be shocked at like even things that you consider healthy, like yogurt has a ton of sugar in it, unless you go for these low sugar options.
Even salt. I bought a salt that had dextrose in it. Like, what? Dextrose is sugar, right?
All different, that's interesting.
All different names. What are some of the ways that I can be more mindful, and someone watching can be more mindful when they go into a store or when they're even just thinking about it?
Well, you know, like you said, read labels carefully. You know, that front of the pack label is unregulated. Right. So
it's the advertising.
Yeah. The back of the pack has the ingredients list and the nutrition profile of the food is regulated by the FDA. The front is free, you know, anything goes.
Yeah.
And so understanding some of that labeling is important. And there's lots of guides out there of how to read those labels, like take eggs, free range, natural. If it has a red barn on it with a chicken roaming and pecking the ground, is that sustainable? You know, it's all of these, there's ways to understand those packages and to make the decisions around purchasing the kind of eggs on the things you care about. If it's animal welfare or, you know, organically fed chickens. So that's one way. Another way is to reduce food waste, which, you know, 30% of all the food we grow is thrown out globally, which is incredible. Mm-hmm. Think about using your freezer more, not buying, you know, bulk of everything. People were doing that during the pandemic. There was a lot of fear about food supply running out, but things are opening up. Maybe you don't need to buy bulk and, you know, save up for the next nuclear holocaust. Right. You know, I don't think you need to have so much food stored in your home. I think you'll be okay.
You never know when you have to barter some toilet tissue.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Yeah. I mean, and how do we get to this place of even providing, you know, something sustainable, not just for here in America, but all around the world?
Yeah. I mean, if people say, well, why should I care about what's going on in Africa or what's going on in Asia? Well, you should, because the US food system is global. We are growing tons of food for the rest of the world, and we are importing food grown in many parts of the world. So you can pretend that you shouldn't care about the rest of the world, but a lot of the food that you're eating is grown on the backs of Africa, Mexico, Latin America, you know, you name it. And if you really want to understand where your food comes from, you have to understand that global picture of who's growing your food and why are they growing that food? Why aren't we growing that in the United States? You're, like you said, you can't grow local food and have the diversity of the kind of foods you want to eat all year round. It's difficult.
It's kind of like, I mean, when I started just eating more local, when I started shopping at farmers markets, there were things that I'd like never heard of before, like kohlrabi and that real tasty green, oh my gosh, arugula.
Arugula.
I mean, like all these different, it's, I think kind of like wherever you're at, you know, you take in what you're supposed to take in, like year round, you know, like people used to eat this way and it kind of simplified life. But do you eat fruits and veggies from other countries or do you prefer to stick local?
No, I eat them from other countries. I mean, I think the biggest thing, you know, there's this kind of, it's a bit ironic, but eating locally is not necessarily the most sustainable. So the food miles, people always think that's the best way to address climate change and the environment. It's not really about the local miles. That has a much lower footprint on the environment than the kinds of foods you choose to consume.
Okay.
And
I saw you write about how quickly the government acted for COVID-19, but not so much for things that affect all of us, like obesity, disease. What do you think?
Climate change.
They were able to mobilize, right?
It's incredible, right? How quickly governments shut down or locked down or, you know, created like significant behavior changes where we had to socially distance or wear masks. And it is a question of why don't governments care about some of these other issues like climate change, like global obesity or hunger? Why don't they get the government traction like COVID did? And I think a lot of it, Kim, is around this idea that you can't see climate change is not in front of your face every day. Well, we're kind of seeing it right now. Look at the Pacific Northwest and the right. East Coast. We're into these massive heat waves and the droughts and wildfires on the West Coast. But, and all of that very much related to climate. But, you know, we don't see it every day. Like COVID impacted every one of us every day. It impacted everything. We're going to get to a state, if we don't address climate change, where it will impact us on a very visceral daily level. But do we want to get to that point where we're in an emergency situation? So I think when governments don't see it in their face, where it's affecting the economy in a very immediate way, it's hard for them to react.
I mean, when you think about it, like the medical field could go broke if everybody just started eating right, right?
Yeah.
There's a lot of money. Someone told me when I was going through the weight loss program, the head of it said, you know, I go, I don't know why everybody doesn't eat this way. He said, you know, there's no money in health.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, you have the food. I know you have to go in a second. You have food in the grocery stores coming from China, from South America. It's difficult to get locally grown food. So are you a big proponent of farmers markets?
I am, as long as they're affordable. Yeah. I think so, you go to some farmers markets. I was just in New York last week, and it's just so expensive, right? So how do you ensure that SNAP benefits work at farmers markets?
Yeah.
So I'm a big advocate of farmers markets, supporting local farmers. They produce great quality foods, but it needs to be profitable for the farmer, but affordable for particularly low income families to be able to access those wonderful farmers markets. So.
And before you go, tell me, did you really spend 18 hours in a lab harvesting cells?
I did.
Do not go crazy.
I did. And that's why I no longer work in a lab.
I love it. Author and Johns Hopkins professor, Jessica Fanzo. This is her book, Can Fixing Dinner Fix the Planet? Sounds like it can. Thank you so much for talking with me here today.
Thank you.
The book is available everywhere books are sold, right?
Yep. Absolutely.
Thanks for your time.
Thank you.